Hello.
Hey.
Hi.
Hi everyone. Welcome to Youth Opportunities Arts Fest 2021. We are so excited to have you all here with us tonight. Originally, Yo Arts Fest was going to be a live event at the amazing Trinity Centre, but unfortunately, due to obvious circumstances, that couldn't go ahead. Nevertheless, we are really grateful to still have the opportunity to showcase some of Bristol's amazing young talent via this online event. So tonight we have a range of different performances and interviews celebrating Bristol's creatives. We have also been working with Bristol-based illustrator Libby Parfitt to bring you a physical map of Bristol's creative opportunities that we will be posting out to all attendees if you wish. So let us know that you're here in the chat. We'll also be putting out work opportunities in there, so make sure to get involved in the comments. So without further ado, let's start Yo Arts Fest 2021.
This one is called That Day at Primrose Hill, and it's based on a real memory, so yeah, I'll just leave that there. That day at Primrose Hill. Come, take my hand. Let me take you back to simpler days. Back, back, way back to school and play, and the August sun of 1999. The sun was especially kind that day, and my hair had just been plaited by my mum, who burned the synthetic ends to stop it from being undone. I was yay high and filled with fun, and everyone was my friend, and Mr. Whippy's ice cream slipped down my throat with that delicious strawberry syrup. It avalanched into my belly with large rolls of satisfying sweetness, and made my belly hang even more childlike, protruding under the pink cotton shirt and over the elastic of my polka dot leggings. I ran around the playground with new friends, and I remember swinging across the monkey bars and trying to get across and jumping down to my feet. I remember the coarse wood chips releasing that wooden flavor into the air. Its purpose, protection. Its function, shock absorption. My big brown eyes scanned the playground in search of what was next, and I caught sight of the mega slide. I see kids like me standing in a line, crawling up the steps and pouring down the metal slide of fun. But oh, what's that? There are big mans all around, and in yellow jackets. Freddie says they've just fixed it, the slide, and that we can go on it. I see kids like me standing in a line, and I too step towards the slide. But all of a sudden, a bulky arm blocks my way, and a huge body blocks the sun. Where are you going? The man asks. He bent down to my level and came close to my face. I'm going to the slide, I said. What can a three-year-old understand from a hateful face and a firm glare? What can a three-year-old take from a look that says, you don't belong here? My determined little frame tried to push past, but it was no use. I asked the strange mean man why I couldn't go on the slide. They can go, but you can't. Why? Because you're an ugly creature. At that moment, I became a cockroach. Tears spewed from my antennae and I scuttled away across the wood chips like an insect. They couldn't protect me from the reality of evil. They couldn't absorb the shock of words spewed with such conviction. At first, my mom didn't believe that an adult had said these things to me. But my crying and tugging of her arm tugged at her instincts that something wasn't quite right. I just remember her shouting at him, and that was the first time I heard the word racist. 20 years later, I reflect on this experience. I still see his outline, huge and sturdy. I wonder where he is and what kind of life he's lived, whether he ever had any children, whether he ever had a little girl like me. I'd like to just, out of curiosity, have coffee with him and have a chat and just say, look here, look at me. I am that girl, but now I can speak and I have something to say. Eons ago, my coarse hair and brown skin were dreamed up in the mind of God. And I am no accident. And I am not subhuman. And I am beautiful, although foolishly sometimes I forget. And I don't hate you. I just want to understand you. Oh, mean man who I met that day at Primrose Hill. Don't be a coward. Explain your reasons. I'm listening. Thank you.
Excited to welcome Leeza Awojobi to Yo Arts Fest. This evening we are seeing your performance of the amazing piece that day on Primrose Hill, and we'd love to get to know you a little bit better. So tell me, Leeza, who are you and what do you do?
Yeah, sure. So I'm Leeza and I'm a poet stroke storyteller, and I've recently ventured into producing as well.
Oh, wow. Amazing. So when did you start performing? How long have you been doing that?
Yeah, I started during uni, so about 5 years ago. But prior to that, I'd done a bit during school. And I set up a poetry spoken word club with my friend at the time. Mm-hmm. And that was like the first time that I really stretched creatively, because I was around other people who were interested in the same thing, and it was from that small group, which met consistently like every week, that I then had the confidence when I went off to uni to do a bit more. Mm-hmm. So yeah, that's when I started.
If you could have any superpower, what would it be?
So it would be to I had to think about this, but it would be to learn languages instantly. Ooh, like literally, cute. So if I go to a different country, I just absorb the language, not just the language, like the concepts within the language, the different nuances of like how that group of people see the world and stuff. That would be mine.
If you could pick like your top two languages that you could just absorb.
This would be like my parents' languages, actually. Okay. So my mum is Cameroonian and her native language is Bakwiri. And I can't speak that. I can kind of understand. And then my dad is Nigerian and his native language is Yoruba. So those would be like the two that I'd want to absorb straight away.
It would be really cool to be able to speak that with your parents. Huh? Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay, amazing. Thank you. In your poetry or in your spoken word, or, you know, even in the things that you produce now, what themes are sort of the main themes that your art explores?
I'm still working that out. Yeah. So like I explore a variety of themes, but I think the thing that unifies all of them is that I mainly explore from the inner life, the emotions, and I love to focus on the perspective of what's going on in the mind, and maybe what people might not ordinarily see or what might not be at face value. I love to focus on our thoughts, desires, and like really like just the human heart. And when I mean the human heart, I don't mean just our emotions, I mean also our will, like the very impulse of someone.
Have you sort of like, looking back on the performances you've given, the work you've shown, is there, you know, a particularly memorable positive response that you can think of, or maybe multiple hopefully positive responses?
Yeah, I can think of a few. One that really left an impression on me was
I was performing at Left Bank. They were doing, they're just like their regular open mic slot. And this woman gave me a note. She seemed quite shy, but like she gave me a note, and in the note it said something like, you know, I think your performance is really powerful. I think you're really beautiful. Like, don't stop, don't stop. At the time I hadn't really performed much in Bristol. So I was just kind of like, you know, branching out a bit and moving out of my comfort zone. So that was really encouraging to me. And
amazing.
Yeah, that has stayed with me.
That's so sweet. Did you keep the note?
Yes. Yeah, I have.
That's such a lovely response. Speaking of Bristol, obviously Yo Arts Fest is Bristol based, and you know, we're here to try and celebrate, you know, Bristol's amazing creative talent. So how long have you, are you from Bristol or did you move here? How long have you been here?
Yeah, so I'm from London originally, but I moved here, I moved here 3.5, and a half years ago. And I moved from uni. I went to uni in Wales, in Aberystwyth, if anybody knows what that is. it's just one of those places. So I did my undergrad there, and then I moved here, actually not to focus on poetry at the time. It was just something that I enjoyed, but I didn't really see it as like something I could do full time or like venture in as a career.
But now you do, you lead workshops and things like that. So you've sort of kind of had an impact, I think, on the Bristol scene in a big way.
Yeah, hopefully, yeah.
Kind of going outside of your creative work, is there, you know, something that you can share, you know, outside of your work that defines you or that, you know, you enjoy doing?
Yeah. So one thing is that I'm very involved with my church, and very kind of passionate about helping Christian communities thrive and grow and think. And I write for a Christian platform called Ayres Magazine. And also co-host the podcast on that as well.
I actually listened to that podcast and I didn't realize it was you until.
Oh, really?
So
that's hilarious.
It's a great podcast. Yeah, really good.
Oh, thanks. That's kind of what it's interesting that you say, like, outside of my practice, because I also see it as linking in some ways, because you know, you're just kind of thinking about like different worldviews and what Christianity means in a very general sense and how it applies to everything.
Cool. And last question, what is your favorite letter of the alphabet?
I don't know, I want to say L, because that's like just L. Like the letter of my name, but I'd go for L.
L for love,
yes.
L for Leeza, L for Laura, L for lots of things. That is the end of our interview, but thank you, Leeza, so much for being a part of Yo Arts Fest.
Great.
And thank you for taking part in the interview as well.
My name is Saili Katebe, and I'm going to be sharing a couple of poems for this festival. It's a shame that we can't do this in real life, but the fact that we have this is everything. we count our blessings. The first poem I'm going to share is a reminder to have those important conversations with our important people in our lives. I think the importance of connection has really shone through in this last year or so. And so this one is My Brother's Keeper. The shadows he carried round often sounded as his brothers did, cluttering the ground all around where his mother lived. Pictures of his past still scattered in his teeth, so every grimace is a glance at the company he keeps. With only morsels of memories for his mates, he paced the quiet spaces that remembered his face. Holding anger as a shield he would wield as he journeyed out into this world, a whirlwind of running mouths. He always hated if they stated that they could relate, the floating heads overstaying their place in his face, vocalizing and theorizing the power play, downplaying the heavy sound of sour days. He perspires through a prison of past, no last wishes to whisk him from this kingdom of glass, no one to ask about the tremors polluting his peace of mind and piecing what I believed to be a kin of my kind. So, I'm sorry. I'm sorry that I missed you when you called me for help. Holding your hell through hellfire, shouldering self, chauffeuring a shell, sheltering this story to tell, never connecting with your comfort, to confine to a cell. Between the quiet and the chaos, you've cradled the crypt, slipped slowly into the same thoughts that labeled you sick, fraternizing with every skeleton you labored to keep, unable to weep, you worried that they'll label you weak. I know these mirrors haven't managed to replicate your ambition. You face reflections rejecting your inner mission, infecting your intuition with doubt, killing your confidence. How can reason conquer this drought without your conscious account? I've scouted sentences centered in grief and reached deep into your courage to enable your speech leaked peace onto these tables so we can eat and enable your weakening sense of self to realize that you are capable. We were brothers before the blood. Brothers before the floods of fear suffocated our love, and I would love nothing more than see you rise above these jagged waves. Hold your faith, don't hold your tongue, talk. Together we can weather any storm. Brother, home is where the heart is. I hope you swing by sometime. That piece is it. I've had that in my repertoire for such a long time. In the same way that the gesture that it encourages doesn't go old. Just when I think that poem has gotten old, it comes back around to remind me. And I think it's important that the bits of work that I have enjoyed, that I do enjoy sharing, do ask me questions. And when I wrote them, I thought I was answering questions. But now when I share the pieces again, I keep hearing the questions that they were asking me. And I think that needs to stay curious, doesn't go away. And the more I do this, the stronger that curiosity gets. And I think I'm privileged in where I stand for all the cards stacked against me. I feel like I'm privileged in what I have access to as far as questions to ask. I think when you're up against something, you're consistently asked to ask questions. And this next piece is for sure was sparked by a question I never thought I'd have to ask myself. I wrote it while I was trying to do the university thing and then became very aware of what culture means for me and how language plays a part in that. And how my connection with my language and the legacy of language within my family play together. And so it sparked up this piece I call Prodigal Child. And just let me know what questions it asks for you, because that'll be quite an interesting point of reference. A prodigal child returns, riding in on his chariot. Hat in his hand, on his heart, trying to bury it. Concealing bleeding lungs. Regretting leaving young, if home is where the heart belongs, he wonders why he'd ever run. But I've been gone too long. Home is a soured sentiment. My tongue curls at the curdled morsels of home that leave my lips. This fermenting familiarity wreaks havoc on my wit, my compass twists, churning chaos into the core of this wayfarer's soul. You see, she may hug me like I never left, but what's left of our conversations begs questions of culture and kinship. My grandmother does not speak English, and I've lost the keys to our conversations. We navigate through our memories with caution, knowing there's a casualty waiting around every turn of phrase. She smiles, I smile, and the silence sings my shame. Dancing across the ivory tips of the elephant in the room, I had forgotten where I come from. So I reach for the strongest branches in our family tree, hoping to see the seams in need of attention. Hoping to be the thread that binds this tapestry of kings and queens buoyed in the sinews of our oral tradition. And I'm not alone in this. The diaspora are calling for home. We are forgotten seeds, caught falling from the tree, unshackled by the rainstorms, we'd suddenly flee. Manufacturing a genesis to jettison grief, ingesting debris, dressing the breeze with our recitatives. We are precipitations of old creations and new personas. Old theatrics just channeled into these new performers. We carry forward what older knowers were handing down, embellishing the dialectics of our father's crown. Now, Vashkuru Valim Pela Mano. My grandfather gave wisdom. I never knew it then, but I know it now, and I hold it proud as I speak my piece. I'll carry the souvenirs my abuelo thought to be precious. Diamonds calcified over centuries worth of pressure, surviving oppression, pressing his legend into my stencil from a lineage of lions. His lessons were my credentials. He offered the gold hidden in his soul. No rhythms from the old ways withered in his hold, so vivid in resolve, bold in his winning ways, showing me the roads that evolved to his glory days. And I've been tracing the constellations his conversations would conjure. Glowing confirmation of all the moments he conquered, from praying for the rain to dancing with the hurricane and carrying that flame that colored my mother's name. There's history folded in my family's diction. History folded in my family's name. Only in appreciating the way the distance brought me closer to the truth could I read between those lines in my grandmother's smile. My grandfather smiled when they held me the keys to my culture, knowing I could never stand alone, never be alone, while the cannons of our continent still echo inside these bones. I will always be a banner of my beginning, regardless of what land I live in. Thank you very much. I hope you enjoyed those two brief poems, and I hope you have a chance to enjoy the rest of the offerings. You can find me at The Blissful Nomad on social media platforms, or visit www.theblissfulnomad.com. I hope you have your questions answered. I hope you have your questions to ask as we keep moving forward and celebrating the opportunities we do have to engage in these dialogues. Until we meet again, stay safe. Love.
enduring the definite, defining 17, following, defining 17, following. 14. Find. Enduring the indefinite. The indefinite. Life. Through death. Control, where I can see the delusion. Enduring through comfort. Enduring through comfort. Endured. Enduring through discipline. Restlessness as an enduring condition is willfulness. Restfulness as an enduring condition is willingness. I relinquish control, or I concede to delusion.
Thank you.
everyone. I'm really excited to welcome Roddy Jodphurs to Yo Arts Fest. And this evening we are seeing your performance of the piece Breakthrough, which is amazing. And we'd love to get to know you a little bit better. So please tell me, who are you and what do you do?
My name is Roddy Jodphurs. I am Bristol's probably most silly drag king. I think I can say that. Oliver might have a go at me for that, but we'll see. Fight me for it, it's fine. Yes, I am a drag king based in Bristol. I perform and produce Bristol Boys with my co-host and co-producer, Mr. Oliver Assen, which is Bristol's premier drag king cabaret. Essentially just kind of creating a space for drag that does not get seen on TV, drag that is not sort of going mainstream at the moment, whatever that means. And what I do personally is just nonsense, really, just silly nonsense.
Other than nonsense, though, what other themes does your art explore, your performance pieces?
Well, Roddy as a character has actually changed quite a bit over the years. Originally, it was very much kind of playing a character, and the character was of, you know, Roderick Jodphurs, this posh boy who was disinherited by his parents and has kind of not got a clue how to survive in the real world as an adult, so has to sort of figure these things out from himself after he's been disinherited. And something over the last couple of years has just made playing a posh man who never has any consequences for his actions and somehow manages to muddle through despite being entirely inept just stopped being as fun lately. Like, something about that just stopped being funny and started being a little bit painful. But also he's kind of changed into what I'm now kind of exploring more, which is playing about with the ideas of gender, playing about with, as a non-binary demisexual, I'm very interested in those identities that aren't in binary categorization. Like, I'm not a boy, I'm not a girl, I'm not straight, I'm not gay, I'm just kind of in the question mark area. And I think there's a lot of fun to be had in the question mark area, but it is a little bit frustrating at times.
Sort of going off that, you know, you said that the character of Roddy Jodphurs has changed over time. Do you, obviously you can't predict the future, but do you see, you know, how your work, your performance might develop in the future?
Absolutely. I'm one of those people who, if you leave me alone in a room with nothing but a brown paper bag, you'll come back and I'll somehow have made paper mache. Like, I can't stop thinking about things. And over lockdown has been actually a really interesting time to experiment, because I installed TikTok. That's fun. That's kind of led me into cosplay, and the overlap between cosplay and drag is like, there's quite a large overlap already, because it's basically just a question of which label you want to apply to yourself. So I found that, like, through lockdown I've started experimenting with different types of makeup, different aesthetics, different ways I can do things, and I think that experimentation is definitely going to carry forward in future. It's going to continue to be exploring new spaces rather than trying to pin myself down to one particular type of storytelling.
Yeah. So I guess there's lots of options out there.
Yeah, I'm very excited to start incorporating drag into cosplay and cosplay into drag, and see kind of what can be transferred between the two.
That sounds fascinating. I've personally never seen that before, so that would be really cool to see. You sort of talked about you're the co-host and producer of Bristol Boys, and we kind of, obviously, Yo Arts is wanting to celebrate the, you know, talent and diversity of Bristol. Can you tell us a bit about how long you've lived in Bristol? Are you from Bristol? And how do you feel like your work has been influenced by the city, or maybe how you might have influenced the city as well?
So I was not born in Bristol. I moved to Bristol about 8 years ago, I think, maybe closer to 9. I can't entirely recall. Time has lost all meaning. I moved to Bristol before lockdown, which was 100 years ago, so who knows. But no, it's been about 8 years, I think. I do think Bristol Boys has had an impact on Bristol. Before us, there wasn't an alt drag show, certainly. I think the drag scene in Bristol generally was a bit more kind of what you might consider the stereotypical drag scene, very sort of cis, white, gay, lots of queens, hardly any kings to my knowledge. So we did kind of create this space, and we are so entirely lucky and blessed to have the audience that we have, because we have found a very dedicated following who were just dying for something a little bit subversive. So we were very happy to provide that. I think Bristol has been instrumental to my growing as a person. I grew up in a town in the middle of nowhere. Well, it wasn't quite in the middle of nowhere, but that was like a half hour bus ride away. Being in a city just had one of those things where I just sort of got here and was like, finally, there are people, there are things, there are activities, there's like just endless amounts of different that you can continue to challenge yourself with, which when you're someone like me who is just in permanent need of stimulation, just like, yes, please.
Busy for that, yeah.
People, things, hello. So yeah, like Bristol is a huge part of my identity, and I think I would like to think that I'm a part of Bristol's identity as well. Yeah.
Just sort of thinking about your past performances, I'm kind of wondering whether there's a particularly memorable, you know, positive response that you've had to any of your performances that you can maybe think of.
There has been, there are two. One was for Breakthrough, which is the weirdest act I do. Like, it's I think a lot of people do consider it like the most me I have managed to put into one song, purely because it is absolutely bonkers. It's an act I'm very proud of that I hate to do because it's very intensive. The first time I performed that, I'd originally created it for the Bristol Boys Queer Prom collaboration show back in 2018, I think. Yeah, probably about 2018. And before that, I tried it out at Scritch, which is a night Oliver Assets runs, which is kind of for performers to test out new things, or for people who haven't been on stage in a while to kind of test the waters. So I performed it at Scritch just to see if it was physically possible to do all of the things I wanted to do. And the response was amazing, because it was just, I didn't really know what was going to happen. I knew what I wanted to happen. I didn't know how well it was going to go. The audience didn't know what was going to happen. So it was just this wonderful, like, we're all going on this journey together. And it just felt really great. The other best reaction is I do an act, which is my pronouns act, where I come out with a t-shirt that has a square of like a sequined square on it. And in the sequins is the word he. But then I reveal through the act that they're actually mermaid sequins, and I can flip them back and forth to reveal different sets of pronouns. And it's basically about my own struggle with figuring out the, you know, binary nature of pronouns doesn't really work for me, but also when you discover the like neutral pronouns like they, sometimes they also feel wrong, just because the fluidity of gender means that you never really feel entirely genderless. And it's just kind of exploring that. And it is a very personal act, but the amount of times that I have had people come up to me afterwards and say, you put it in words, like you expressed the thing that I have been trying to express, just always makes me happy, because it's great to find fellow very confused people.
Is there something that you can tell us, I guess, that's, I'm sure it's all interlinked, but is there something sort of outside of your work that is, you know, makes you specific to you, or that you'd like to share with everyone?
I think the best thing to find is my YouTube channel is Vanda Does Everything. And my TikTok is Jodphurs. My TikTok is a collection of whatever I feel like doing that week. So there's poetry, there's cosplay, there's drag, there's sometimes just me rambling on about nonsense. And the YouTube channel is longer form me rambling on about nonsense. So if you want a longer video, it's right there for you.
If you could have any superpower, what would it be?
I mean, I feel like the obvious answer is shapeshifting. Like,
yeah,
that's just a fairly standard answer, really. Like, it would be great to be able to look like this without doing an hour of makeup. That would be amazing. Or I think what I would love to do is create like holographic illusions psychically. So I could just kind of go like, this is what I am imagining. This is what I have in my head.
Oh, wow.
If I could just display that for other people and they could go, wow, yes, that's a great idea. And then not actually have to physically do it.
Yeah.
That would be amazing. That would be wonderful. Like, either of those would be amazing.
And lastly, please finish the sentence. The thing I love most about being a performer is...
The thing I love most about being a performer is the moment when I step on stage, when every time before I go on stage, I'm nervous. Like, I have no idea if this is the one that no one is going to get. Like, have I just entirely misunderstood how human beings work? And when I get on stage, there's always a moment where the first joke or the first, you know, line, whatever it is, has the impact I wanted it to have. That first laugh or that first gasp or whatever it is that I'm trying to elicit, when I feel a room full of people go, yes, we're coming with you on this, is an amazing feeling. And yeah, just honestly, one of the best feelings in the world.
Okay, well,
Ooh, and chips. When you're a performer, you can eat chips. You can eat chips and no one will stop you. Like, what's your meal for today? Chips. Okay, fine. Like, no questions. It's great.
Design a show in which you ate chips.
I did just create a digital drag act where I just eat an entire cheesecake. That's the entire act. It's just me eating a cheesecake. So perfect. Chips is clearly the next creative step.
Well, thank you so much for being part of your Arts Fest and for taking part of the interview.
Thank you so much for having me. It's been an absolute pleasure.
Hiya, we're drag. We're going to do two songs for you. This first one's called Don't Call Me Your Girlfriend.
Call me girlfriend, call me a date and for a was Don't Call Me Your Girlfriend, and this is our second song, and it's called Life's a Drag. And we want to say thanks to Youth Opportunities Fest 2021 for having us. Have a good night.
Thank you so much for being here, everyone. We really hope you enjoyed Yo Arts Fest 2021. Make sure to follow all the amazing performers that you've seen tonight. And remember, if you want to receive a physical map of Bristol's creative spots, you can register via the email address that we have linked in the description below. Thank you so much, Bristol. Stay safe and well, and keep creating.
Bye.
Bye.
Bye.